blessed be his kingdom, now and forever.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Said to her, How long will you make a drunken spectacle of yourself? Put away your wine. But Hannah answered, No, my Lord, I am a woman deeply troubled. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman, for I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation all this time. Then Eli answered, Go in peace. The God of Israel grant the petition you have made to him. And she said, Let your servant find favor in your sight. Then the woman went to her quarters, ate and drank with her husband, and her countenance was sad no longer. They rose early in the morning and worshiped before the Lord. Then they went back to their house at Ramah. Elkanah knew his wife Hannah, and the Lord remembered her. In due time, Hannah conceived and bore a son. She named him Samuel, for she said, I have asked him of the Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. second reading today is from the letter to the Hebrews. Every priest stands day after day at his service, offering again and again the same sacrifices that can never take away sins. But when Christ had offered for all time a single sacrifice for sins, he sat down at the right hand of God, and since then has been waiting until his enemies would be made a footstool for his feet. For by a single offering he has perfected for all time those who are sanctified. And the Holy Spirit also testifies to us, for after saying, "This is the covenant that I will make with them after those days, says the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their own minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin." Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, that is, through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
thrown down. This is but the beginning of the birth pains. In the name of God, who shows us the path of new life. Amen. Our opening hymn today was Lord Christ, when first thou camest to earth. And I remember singing this hymn on the Sunday after September 11th, 2001. And I was struck that day with verse 2 of the hymn. O awful love, which found no room in life where sin denied thee, and doomed to death must bring to doom the powers which crucified thee. Till not a stone was left on stone, and all those nations cried, O overthrown, went down to dust beside thee. As I sung those words in those moments of fear and trembling that Sunday, after that awful Tuesday, September 11th, 2001, I was reminded that life is indeed a cycle of decay and destruction, but also rebuilding and rebirth. As of 2001, in a little bit different way, we find ourselves in a place where buildings decay and need reworking and renovation, but we're also today, as in 2001, aware, more aware than ever, of a deeper cycle of decay and rebirth, of falling apart and rebuilding. How do we know the way forward, though, when some of our foundational institutions seem to be decaying and crumbling before our eyes? A fact that this pandemic time has only highlighted. When our foundational markers, our government, our church, our schools, our community organizations, our businesses, seem now, many, to be struggling to survive, the foundational markers that we knew were beginning to fray before the pandemic now seem to have major tears that keep them from being able to hold the social fabric that is our life together. How do we know the path forward without those organizations we depend on existing as we come to depend on them? Monastic Brother James Kester of Society of St. John the Evangelist has said this: for a path forward to be a path, you have to be able to see it, or at least catch glimpses of it every so often. And for that to happen, somebody needs to have walked ahead of you. We may not be able to see them, but here and there they have left a sign, a shoe, or a boot abandoned in the muck. Something they have dropped, a pile of stones, a depression in the grass, a way marker inscribed with an arrow pointing the way, or simply the holiness of their lives. This is the way, they say to us, walk in it. This is where the great communion of saints, living and dead, are so vital. We're in the season of All Saints, and in times of extreme spiritual turbulence, our great communion of saints can show us the path to new life once again. Today, and perhaps for the year to come, I'd like to focus on Saint Benedict and his rule. The Benedictine tradition has deeply influenced the Anglican and Episcopal traditions, not only in worship, but in the ordering of our common life as the body of Christ together. The world in which Saint Benedict was born was troubled, torn apart, and uncertain. He knew little of safety or security, and the church in his time was almost as troubled as the secular world. The world of 400 Common Era was a world without landmarks. Rome had fallen in 410, 70 years before the birth of St. Benedict, and it was a traumatic shock to the entire civilized world. Different tribal groups were ravaging northern Italy, and Rome was sacked a second time. The church was torn apart by theological conflicts, actually around the doctrine of grace. They were in conflict. There was much in common, actually, with the 21st century of the pandemic. Life was an urgent struggle to make sense of what was happening. No one knew which way to turn. Benedict was born in the year 480 in Umbria in Italy. And as many great saints over the centuries, he was born to a family of high station. He went to Rome to study liberal arts, but left after a short time, abandoning the city and running for the hills to a cave in Sudafrica for 3 years. He was discovered in this cave, hiding out, by other seekers wanting to know the way forward, and soon a community developed around him. And the rule of St. Benedict, which many monastic communities based their common life on, was written by Benedict and his community to survive together in such turbulent times. So it seems to me it might be time to return to the Benedictine way once again, and in a way that informs the beginning of our own Episcopal heritage, and to do it with attention. Returning to our Benedictine roots in the coming year will help us to discern the way forward in the post-pandemic world as a Christian community. After our annual meeting today, which will take place right in here, just after the service, we'll have a new vestry and new wardens to take the reins of leadership. Emmanuel's officers and vestry these past 18 months have held our ship of faith steady. They have been the incarnational anchor for us these past 18 months. As I reviewed last year's annual meeting in March 2020, we unrolled at that meeting the Stone and Light campaign. Not long after that meeting, we had to shutter our doors for worship and began to learn a whole new way of virtually worshiping together. Our Washington Street wall fell through years of unseen decay underneath, and we suspended the Stone and Light campaign during the pandemic. Instead, we watched as our stone mason crew built back the wall using the original stones. With a small band of committed folks, we kept things moving, sending out mailings and emails, recording worship and anthems, keeping our building, grounds, and cemetery sound, hosting tours where we could, and taking the lead to prepare for our future by purchasing Point House as an outreach for the community. Well done, good and faithful leadership. You have been our anchor these past 18 months. Time for you to give the ship's wheel to more saints who will lead us into uncharted waters. So as we begin this journey, I'd like to suggest three parts of the rule as a way to approach our discernment in the year ahead. And these are three foundational markers of Benedict's rule. First, listening. Esther Duval, who's written a lot about Benedict, has said to listen closely with every fiber of our being at every moment of the day is one of the most difficult things in the world. And yet it is essential if we mean to find the God we are seeking and God's ways to follow. And we're not truly attentive and listening unless we are prepared to act on what we hear. We also need to listen to ourselves and learn to love ourselves in the midst of this, paying attention to our body and its demands and rhythms, which we often push underground and just keep going. So in this year ahead, I'd like us to listen to God's word, to our community, to one another, to our inner voice. What rhythms of worship, study, outreach, hospitality, and service work for each of us and our community? How can we stay whole and healthy as individuals who serve Christ in this place, as well as a community of believers and seekers who show forth Christ's love in the world? What needs to be let go of and what needs to continue? We need to listen to God's word among us and within us to know the path. So there'll be opportunities that the vestry will help lead around listening and discernment, both as individuals and community. So listening is the first foundational tenet of St. Benedict's rule. The second is stability, the issue of commitment and fidelity, the need not to run away, the need to listen and to feel earthed in this place, to be steadfast. Without roots, we can neither discover where we belong or where we can grow. And it's hard to have a rooted lifestyle these days because we have a bewildering amount of choices about what we can do, not only with Sundays, but our whole life. Monastic stability means accepting a particular community, a place, a people, this and no other as the way to God. It is truly the anchor that holds us in a restless, uncharted sea. Are you committed to staying faithful and steadfast to the Emmanuel community? I know that I am. Through this time of pandemic, I've been to Rose Hill Cemetery a good deal, as we continue to be good stewards of that resting place for many good souls. And when I go, I always take a trip to the rector's plot there. If you didn't know, that's one of the benefits of being rector, is you get to be buried at Rose Hill. As these 18 months have passed, I'm ready for that to be the resting place of my body, and hopefully Brian's. I feel rooted to this place in a way I have not since my childhood. And now that feeling of rootedness is even deeper after what we've been through together. I'm committed to this place and would like to work with you all in the next year to find out how to take sabbatical time, because it's time for me to take that, and my body and soul know that, as well as help you to continue to discern the way forward together as a community as we move into a new world. Now, Charlie is going to speak to more on that at annual meeting, so be sure to stick around. We need to make a steadfast commitment to this sacred place and see it through thick and thin, as countless saints have done before us. So, listening, stability. Are you committed to staying faithful and steadfast to the Emmanuel community? And finally, there's this amazing balance that the rule requires of us, to listen, to be stable and steadfast, but then to change. The third hallmark of the Benedictine rule is change. Just as we need to commit to a place and people of God, Benedict asks us in his rule to be ready for the transformative change that God's love and word bring to a place and a people. Obedience to this transformation is critical, just as obedience is critical for stability and listening. Now, I can't foretell what our transformation will be, but I know we all feel those birth pangs of transformation. The only way forward is to keep finding our path by listening to God and one another, being anchored in this place in steadfastness, but also being ready to step into the transformative calls placed before us as individuals and community in the year and years to come. Are you ready for the change, for the transformation? Benedict was ready, and we have so many saints over the years that were ready. I've just watched the Suffragist documentary on American Masters, and I know Elizabeth Lowndes was ready. Bob Riggs was ready. Mary Ann Chapman was ready. Saints that have left us in this year. Countless saints of God are ready for their transformation. And now they are unseen, but just as at our shoulder, ever present to cheer us onward to Emmanuel's transformation, a place they dedicated their lives to. The final verse of Lord Christ when thou camest to earth is this: O wounded hands of Jesus, build in us thy new creation. Our pride is dust, our vaunt is stilled. We wait thy revelation. O love that triumphs over loss, we bring our hearts before thy cross to finish thy salvation. So, Emmanuel, I am listening. I am here. I am ready. Let us stand and affirm our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed on page 358 of your prayer books. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers to the people are for the three, as found on page 387. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons. We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let life and perpetual shine.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
We also want to share your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and for those of others.
We particularly pray for those who have been in the hospital or in the hospital, for John Helmstetter, for Dick Coleman, for Kitty Madden. And we also remember those saints who have passed from our sight, Mary Ellen Sir and Bob Riggs. We also remember today the life and witness, steadfastness, obedience of Beau Chapman and Mary Ann Chapman for the dedication of their their life to this place. Lord Jesus Christ, you stretched out your arms of love on the hardwood of the cross, that everyone might come within the reach of your saving embrace. So clothe us in your Spirit that we, reaching forth our hands in love, may bring those who do not know you to the knowledge and love of you, for the honor of your name. Amen. On page 360 of your prayer book, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand and bow to one another with the peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. So I invite you all to be seated for a few announcements. Welcome to Emmanuel. Glad you've come back for another 10 o'clock service after our great celebration of Bob Briggs' life last week. We're still online. We'll be online at this service going forward. One of the things that you might notice if you pay attention to liturgical colors is I do have a white stole on. Now today we're still in that great green season where I generally wear green. But you know, I think I just put this on intuitively today. I've been wearing this a lot lately, especially for last week and at All Saints, but also at Graveside and Maryland Serve. So it seems like today is one of those days of resurrection, so I have my white stole on, and we all are starting on a new path. I hope that you'll stay for annual meeting. That's one of those things that folks often slip away from, but today we're going to try to make it as short as we can. We'll stay in this space so people can hear well, but after the service, take a bathroom break. There's water, I think, over there on the table. You're welcome to bring it in here. Just take a little trip, walk in the beautiful gardens outside, and come back in, and we'll, I hope, do this in under an hour. It just depends on discussion of what we'll bring to you. So please do stay and be with us. Next week is Christ the King Sunday, and we, as you can see, we have quite a number of children that are appearing, and they're going to sing for us next Sunday at the end of the service, a blessing, and we'll also have the bells back with us again. So please do come with us. A couple of other things. There are lots of opportunities for giving back to the community, and you have them in your insert. Please take a look. On the Sunday after Thanksgiving, we'll have our trees up in the cloister where you can pick up paper angels for gifts for our Head Start children on Cumberland Street. Also, we'll be making shoe boxes this year, not for Franklin Brands shipping overseas, but we're going to give them out in community here, and there'll be more information about that if you've never done a Christmas shoe box. It's a lot of fun. And of course, we'll do hats, scarves, and mittens for our school children. We also this year have a couple of events I just want to highlight through Thanksgiving. FSU has a fledgling opera department, and JJ, our FSU tenor, is singing one of the lead roles in the Mall of the Night Visitors, and the Emmanuel Choir are part of the Shepherds, if you've ever seen that. JJ is cast bar, so we're looking forward to seeing him in that. So you can come tomorrow night or Tuesday night, or wait till Sunday, December 12th at 5, when we'll have them all here. The Monday and Tuesday shows are up at Peeler at FSU campus at 7:30. There's a big dress rehearsal tonight. So please, it's a wonderful way to support our FSU students and the opera program there. Also, not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday, Thanksgiving Eve, and the three churches, Lutheran, Presbyterian, and Emmanuel, are going to come together for Thanksgiving Eve service here at Emmanuel at 7. There'll be a pickup choir. You can come and sing at 6, an easy anthem for that. And if you want to sing some more, the Friday after Thanksgiving will be, we've been asked, the choir or anyone else in the manual has been asked to sing for the tree lighting, which you know the manual tree plays a big role. So we'll be down there at 6 o'clock. We'll sing some secular carols, and then a few of us will rush up the hill to turn on the young Christmas tree. So there's a sign-up sheet in the cloister where you can sign up to be with us on that Friday, and we're going to hand out some carols next Sunday so you can know what we're singing after church. Also on the cloister table are your third quarter pledge statements, and you can pick those up as well. But I hope you'll stay for annual meeting. And as you heard pastorally, a few folks have had some procedures. John Helmstetter had a carotid artery procedure that went well this past week. Dick Coleman has had open heart surgery, but he's come back in the hospital for some healing. And please keep the whole Coleman family in prayer. Kitty Madden has also had abdominal intestinal surgery. She's at home healing. And I think all those folks, maybe not visits, but would love cards just to know that you're thinking about them. So, and as you heard, also Mary Ellen Surf, in addition to Bob Briggs, died in the past month, and she died at 104. And her daughter and friends and said goodbye to her at Up Churches and at the cemetery. So, any other announcements?
Pledge cards.
Pledge cards. Oh, yes, you should have received your pledge card in your newsletter, but we don't know how the mail's doing these days, right? The U.S. Postal Service. So if you didn't get a pledge card, we'd love to have those in today, but if you put them in the offering plate at the back or bring them by the office, but they're extra pledge cards out on the cloister table. So the vestry thanks you. So walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
have we given you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. In obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread, and when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. page 365 of the prayer books. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace, and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always.
Amen.